Let's start our service tonight with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to once again come into your house and hear your word. We pray that as we now lift up our voices to you, that it would be with sincerity of heart, and that it would be a sweet offering to you, Lord. We pray that we would be receptive to your words this evening, as given by your servants, Lord. Lord, we praise you and thank you for all it is that you do for us. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Please stand and let's begin with singing Majesty.
Majestad, Gloria Su Majestad, Dada. lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
Let's pray. Father, we are grateful that you have given us the privilege of being part of your ministry here on earth, part of your plan here on earth. And that as part of that plan, Father, you've given us the privilege to give of our time and our talents and our treasure. And so, Father, we just ask that as we consider the offering, the financial giving of the church, that you would first give us generous hearts, cheerful hearts as we give, and that also, Father, you'd give us wisdom as to how to use those funds in a way that gives the utmost glory to your name. And then again, we thank you, Father, that you even consider us worthy, because you don't need us, Lord, but you choose to use us, and for that we are grateful and will be eternally grateful. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, amen.
Continue singing with Blessed Be the Name.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
As you remain standing, I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles in 2 Chronicles chapter 20.
Segunda de Crónicas.
Capítulo 20. We're going to read verses 6 through 14. Segunda de Crónicas, capítulo 20, versículos 16 al 14. O Lord God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven, and do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand, is there not power and might, so that no one is able to withstand you? Are you not our God, who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel, and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend, forever? And they dwell in it, and have built you a sanctuary in it for your name, saying, if disaster comes upon us, sword, judgment, pestilence, or famine, we will stand before this temple and in your presence, for your name is in this temple, and cry out to you in our affliction. And you will hear and save. And now, here are the people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whom you would not let Israel invade when they came out of the land of Egypt, but they turned from them and did not destroy them. Here they are, rewarding us by coming to throw us out of your possession, which you have given us to inherit. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power against this great multitude that is coming against us. Nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. Now all Judah with their little ones, their wives, their children, stood before the Lord. And then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jahaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaniah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, in the midst of the assembly. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Eternal Father, we want to thank you for the blessing of this privilege you give us to assemble together, the moment you give us to be able to lift up our voices and sing and praise you, but also open our ears to hear as you speak to us from your word. We thank you for letting us read your word publicly, and we thank you for this opportunity to reflect on it. And we pray, Lord, that you would speak to us with this word, that we would be able to understand, and that your spirit would also be at work creating in us the will to do what pleases you. We thank you for this time, and just pray your blessing in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. So with the message tonight, I want to continue with the second message in the series from this passage of Scripture in 2 Chronicles 20 that focuses on the victory that God can bring into the life of his people, into your life and also into my life, regardless of what threats we may face or what threats we may be presently facing. So with tonight's message, the series message is entitled Victory, and the focus tonight is Victory, a Prayer Response to Threat. Now, last Sunday with the message in this series I shared with you on a biblical response to threat, and we're looking at the first part or the first verses here in chapter 20, and we were answering the question of what we ought to do or what ought to be our initial response when our lives encounter that which threatens us. And the biblical response is that we may react with initial fear, but yet we ought to bring that fear to the Lord. And when we're looking at Jehoshaphat's testimony, we saw that fear was his initial response, but Jehoshaphat did not allow the fear of the threat that was coming to paralyze him or to cause him to run and to flee. But instead, what he did was he took that and brought that fear to the Lord, and he presented himself to the Lord. And so when Jehoshaphat presented himself to the Lord, we find there in the text that he had sought the Lord. He had proclaimed the fast. He gathered the people to come together, and the people came from all over as a congregation of Israel, and together they sought the face of God, and they sought help from the Lord. What we have read here in these passages or in these verses today is the prayer response. So as they came together and they sought the Lord and brought their prayer to the Lord, what was the focus of their praying? And this is very important as we move forward with this reflection. And so I want to answer the question tonight concerning our prayer focus. When we find ourselves seeking the Lord's help in the face of threat in our own lives, how should we pray? What should be the focus of our praying? And this is not a question about whether or not we will pray. One of the interesting things that I've heard over the years, and someone said to me, and this was someone from the military at that said to me that in the foxhole there are no atheists. And what they were saying that is that, yeah, if you understand what the foxhole is, that's the holes they dig out, the soldiers dig in there, and they kind of create their perimeter, and that's their defense. But they're in the ground. They make these holes in the ground, and they just stick up over them. But he says in the foxhole there are no atheists, being that when bullets start flying over your head, everyone has a tendency to call out to God. Even the one who says, I don't believe in God, is all of a sudden praying and asking of God. And I say that because when threat comes upon our life, oftentimes it is a tendency to just respond and all of a sudden realize there is a God and I need God and I call out to God. But the question is, what's the focus of our praying? Because sometimes the praying can be, and if we're in the foxhole, the prayer is, Lord, just don't let those bullets hit me. Lord, just save my life. Or Lord, help me out of here. Or Lord, help us to advance. But when we find ourselves in the face of threat in our own lives, what is the focus of our praying as we present that prayer to the Lord or we inquire the help from the Lord? And so for our reflection, we'll be answering that question. How is it that we respond to the Lord? And I said, this is not a question about whether or not we'll pray, because somehow, some way, whenever we're threatened, that word, that message, that telegram, whatever you want to call it, ends up going up to the Lord. But as we've read here in this passage of scripture, we discover that Jehoshaphat's prayer began with a kind of a series of rhetorical questions. And the questions that he's asking of God is not to get an answer from God about these questions, but is rhetorical in the sense that the answer to each of these questions was the assurance that, yes, the Lord is all these things. But he's just reflecting in that way and presenting that prayer to the Lord. But one of the things we see in Jehoshaphat's prayer is that everything with him shifts from the fear that he initially had to that focus of faith in the Lord. And that's a beautiful thing, because this reveals something about our blessing in the prayer relationship that we have from the with the Lord. Because we really need to be a people who thank God that we can actually come to God in prayer and ask of the Lord in whatever situation that we're in. And not only can we come to God, but we know that the access that we have to God and the confidence that we have to actually come to God is because of what God has done for us through his son, Jesus Christ. We can read passages like in the book of Hebrews that remind us that Jesus Christ is our high priest. And because he is our high priest, we're invited to come with boldness to the throne of grace to obtain grace and mercy in our time of need. If we're not in Christ, we don't have that promise. We don't have that authority. And we won't have that confidence. But we have that privilege to be able to come to the Lord. The prayer relationship with the Lord is a very important relationship that we enjoy with God. And so we're able to come to the Lord, and we're able to take that which initially scares us or breeds fear in us and be able to turn our heart's attention to the Lord and exercise faith rather than fear. But prayer, when we come to God in prayer, our prayer ought not be a kind of haphazard kind of responds to the situation that's going on, like if you were the soldier in the foxhole and all you're worried about is being able to survive that battle. Our prayer as we come to the Lord should not be an attitude or with the attitude of, well, there's nothing else to do, and so therefore let me do this. Let me supposedly ask of God. Our prayer must be a prayer in faith. And James wrote that and helped us to understand that when he says that we should count it all joy when we fall into all kinds of trials. So whatever is threatening your life, there's reason to rejoice. And he goes on to say, because we know that the trying of your faith produces patience. And when we let patience have its perfect work, we become perfect and entire, wanting nothing. But sometimes we don't understand how that works. So in verse 5, he goes on to say that if any man lacks wisdom, he can ask God, who is willing to give it freely and liberally to all who ask him. But in verse 6, he gives a warning that when you pray, you got to ask in faith. You cannot ask doubting, because otherwise you're like the wave of the sea that is tossed back and forth and you're good for nothing, basically. So faith is very important. It can't be haphazard, oh, well, there's nothing else to do. And it can't be just a flippant idea, well, if there's nothing else to do, let me do this. We have to come with a sense of confidence to God and present our prayer to God, bringing our fear to the Lord and leaving that fear with the Lord. So as we look at this prayer focus in the life of Jehoshaphat, there's a few things that I want to highlight as we go through here, especially in verses 6 and 7 to begin with. Because the first thing we notice here through these verses is that Jehoshaphat's prayer acknowledges the person of God. Now, if you look there in verse 6 and 7, you notice he says, O Lord, our God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven, and are you not ruler over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand, is there not power and might so that no one is able to withstand you? And then verse 7, are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people and gave it to the descendants of Abraham and your friend forever? Now, I said these are rhetorical questions. If we were to answer every one of those questions, or if the Lord was to answer those questions to Jehoshaphat, the Lord would say, yes, that's who I am. But who is the Lord? As we look at this prayer focus on the Lord, as I mentioned, Jehoshaphat acknowledges first the person of God. And in this acknowledgement of the person of God, we see that he acknowledges the personal relationship with God. If you look there, the first words in verse 6, he addresses the Lord, and even though it's in these rhetorical questions, but his address to the Lord is identifying God as God of our fathers. It's a personal relationship with God. And if we remember the words of the Lord Jesus when he instructed his disciples on praying, Jesus said, when you pray, this is the way you pray. He said, you say, our Father who art in heaven. That was just the beginning of that prayer. But those instructions of the Lord Jesus are emphasizing the importance of the relationship with God through his Son, Jesus Christ. When we come to God, he is God, but he's not a distant God. He's not a foreign God. He's a personal God. We are in a personal relationship with God. He is our Father and we are his children. That's very important. Because literally all of the promises about prayer and the invitations to prayer, all of it rests in that relationship with God. And if we are not in the right relationship with God through his Son, Jesus Christ, we don't have those promises. But thank God that as we come to him, our God is very personal to us. He is our Father. Yes, he's the Almighty. Yes, he's the Omnipotent One. Yes, he is the All-Knowing. Yes, he is All-Wise. But he who is all that and more is my Father. And you remember the words of the Apostle Paul expressing the way that we can address God in that relationship that we have with him when he says in Romans 8 that we can call out to him and say, Abba, Father, or in Spanish we would say, Papi, Papi, or my daddy. That's very personal. That's the relationship that we enjoy. And based on that relationship, we have all of the promise of who he is. We have all of the backing of who God is to take care of us in our lives. But also here you'll notice that as he continues this prayer, he acknowledges also the sovereignty of God. And in the second part of verse 6, he says, are you not God in heaven? Again, the answer is rhetorically, yes, he is God in heaven. But remember even there the instructions of the Lord Jesus. When you pray our Father who art in heaven, or our Father who art in heaven. Acknowledging not only the relationship that we have with the Lord, but acknowledging the position and disposition of our God. One of the wonderful things, and I always go back to Isaiah 57:15, as one of the wonderful promises or realities about our relationship with God. In Isaiah 57:15, it states that he is the high and holy one who inhabits all of eternity, whose name is holy. That's identifying our God in heaven. But then the very next part of the verse, the very end of that verse 15 in Isaiah 57 says, and he dwells among those who are broken and contrite in heart in order to heal the broken in spirit. And that's a beautiful promise about that relationship. But also understanding that God who holds that sovereignly high position, he is not way out there. He's right here even in my brokenness. That is why when the threat comes and our initial response may be that of fear, it's okay. Because my God is right there, the Almighty, the Omnipotent God, who inhabits all of eternity, who is the Holy One, the Sovereign One in heaven, is also right there with us, alongside us. And so when we pray, we have to have that acknowledgement as well. Otherwise, our prayer is not really a prayer in faith. Because our prayer may be just an expression of desperation to get out of a situation with no acknowledgement as to who God is. But the third thing I see here is the acknowledging of the authority of God. At the end of verse 6, where he says, in your hand is there not power and might so that no one is able to withstand you? Again, the answer is yes. But acknowledging there the authority of God. Everything literally is in the hands of God. And when I look at the testimony of Scripture, and I look again and again at the events that take place or the experiences that the children of God have throughout history, throughout biblical history, and you watch the threats that come upon them again and again, one of the things you clearly see in it, if you really pay attention to the text, is that regardless of what's happening, the Lord is still the Lord. He is still in authority. He is still in control. He's not just a sovereign that rules over it, but he has the authority, and whatever he says is what must be. You remember that in the testimony of Job, when the Lord, the text tells us that Satan was roaming around on the earth, going back and forth, and the Lord called him into account and asked him, "What are you doing?" And he says, "Oh, I'm just going around checking things out and doing the devil thing." And then the Lord says, "Have you taken notice of my servant Job?" And yeah, Satan had taken notice of Job. But Satan says, "Yeah, I notice him, but I can't do nothing against him. You don't let me." You know what that says to you and I? God is the authority. He is a sovereign one in control of everything. Satan had to ask permission. "Oh, Lord, if you let me do this and let me do that, I bet you I can make Job curse you." "Well, I'm going to let you do that, but you can't do no more than that." And Satan went and did that first thing. And then Satan comes back on the next one and says, "Ah, Lord, but if you let me do this." And the Lord said, "You can do that, but only to this extent." But again, it shows that God is in control. He is the authority over everything. He truly is Lord over everything. When we look at the life and ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ on earth, we can see that again and again in the testimonies of the gospel, that the Lord Jesus Christ is the authority. He truly is Lord. He showed that he is Lord over nature as he found himself in the boat with his disciples, and he's sleeping, taking a good nap, and they're panicking because they're in the storm and they believe we're going to die. They awaken him. What does he do? With just the sound of his word, "Be still," in the storm is calmed and the winds stop. He's authority. He has the authority over nature. No sooner as they get to the other side of the lake and they encounter a demoniac in Gadara, and this man comes out of the tombs and he's going crazy, and then all of a sudden the Lord handles that situation, and the next thing you know is that the demoniac is sitting down in his right mind. One that was uncontrollable by anyone and everything else is found in his right mind. Because the Lord is the authority over the spiritual realm. And on we can go and look at the testimony of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we find that he is the authority over sickness. And he is the authority over death and life. And he is authority over everything. Because that's who he is. "Oh Lord, in your hands is it not the power and might, so that no one can withstand you." And one of the beautiful things when you look at the Psalms and you look at even in the Proverbs, and we learn this concept, that when God puts his plans in motion, there is no one that can stand against God's plans. There is no one that can thwart the plans of God, is what the scripture tells us. He's the Lord. He's the authority. But also here you'll notice in verse 7 that he acknowledges the grace of God in the past. Jehoshaphat is acknowledging that God is the one that drove out the inhabitants of the land before his people. And as God drove out those inhabitants of the land, God gave it to the children of Israel as an inheritance. Now, if you go back in the Old Testament and you read those accounts, and I especially like looking at it in from the perspective of Deuteronomy chapter 8, because in Deuteronomy 8, the Lord starts out by saying that he had brought them out in the wilderness and he was testing them to see if they really would trust the Lord. And then he goes on to talk about how you're going to go into the land, and you're going to go into land that you're going to eat from fruit and trees that you did not plant. You're going to live in houses you did not build, and on and on. All of it communicating that you deserve none of this. But this is an act of the grace of God. And how many things in our own life we look at and we see and we can enjoy and we benefit from and we're blessed by, but there's not one of it that we merited, but it's the grace of God. And we especially look at that in salvation. And if it was not for the grace of God, where would we be? That's why I love that passage in Psalms 103 when he states that he has not dealt with us according to our sins. Imagine if God had dealt with us or did deal with us now according to our sins. We wouldn't be. When the payment of sin is death, and that's what we deserve. But God has been gracious to us. Israel did not deserve the land. But God, in his mercy and grace, he chose Israel. He set them apart. He put his hands upon them. And whatever they encountered and whatever challenges were there, God was there to deliver them. And as God gave them that land, it was God who drove out that enemy and gave them the victory because of the grace of God. But then also we see in verse 8 an acknowledging that there's an acknowledgement of the accomplished blessing of God's word that was fulfilled in their lives. When he talked about this grace of God and what God had done and provided for them, driving out the enemy and giving them the land as an inheritance, again, something that they did not deserve. In verse 8, Jehoshaphat is recognizing, God, this is what you said you would do. And the reality is, we're there. We dwell in that land. As if to say, Lord, you spoke it, you promised it, and what we're living is in the experience of it, because you are true to your word. We dwell in it. In the face of threat sometimes in our lives, we look at our weakness, we look at what challenges us, we look at our limitations, we look at what we think we still lack or what we need in our lives. And as long as we do that, we really know not anything about the blessing of God. And one of the things we need to learn to do and exercise in doing in our lives is, in the face of threat, acknowledge these things we've been talking about, but especially acknowledge how much God has fulfilled of his word in our lives. We can see the grace of God working and how we benefit from his grace. It's all fulfillment of his promises. God said he would do that. And if he's doing it in your life, don't look at what's missing or what you think is missing or look at your limitation and weaknesses. Look at the abundance and the faithfulness of God in fulfilling what he said he would do. That's where we gain courage. Because God, if you brought us from there through all of that to here, it doesn't matter what this is right here, because you will do it again. You've done it in the past. You'll do it again. This is the God that we serve. This is the God that we are lifting our voice up to in prayer and asking of him. In verse 9, you notice that there was also the acknowledging of the Lord's promised protection. It's not just what you've done and the way that you fulfilled your promise to bring us to this point, and now here we are dwelling in the very land that you said we would dwell in, but in your presence, he says, we find ourselves in your presence, and we know that we cry out to you. We know that you will save. What a blessing to have that assurance. One of the things that I've been doing for a couple years is trying to instruct us, especially in our prayer gatherings, on the importance of learning to pray scripture, for example. Because scripture, there we're looking at what God has said, not what we imagine, not what we think, what we want to present to the Lord or our own agenda, but here's what God has literally said, whether it's promise or command, whatever God has spoken. And we take that word and we learn to stand on that word, we begin to realize that God truly is faithful, and God is going to come through with what he said he's going to do. And so when it comes to our need of protection in our life, how important it is to hold on to such promises. You know, I think of the spiritual warfare that we're in, and the enemy's working many, many different and difficult ways. But what scripture comes to your mind? I don't know, but one of the ones that comes to my mind is where John says that greater is he that is in me than the one that is in the world. In the face of that kind of threat, I have confidence, not in myself, but I can have confidence in the word of God and in the promised protection of God. I will take care of you. Romans 8:28, for we know that in all things God works together good, works good in all things in the life of those who love him, Now, if I'm walking with the Lord and loving on the Lord and abiding in that relationship with the Lord, I have the assurance of that promised protection. So come what may come, it may be difficult, it may be beyond me understanding what this is all about, but one thing I can rest in is somehow, some way, God will take that and work good in it and bring it through it, bring us through it. And that's one of the things that I admire about Sonia's testimony. And in times past when I've sat with her and she tells me about her past and all the bad things that happened in her life and how she was abandoned and neglected and these things that took place in her life, but how she tells me and says, but I am so thankful it happened. Because if those things did not happen, I would never have seen my need for God. If everything was working good in my life, then I would think to myself, why do I need God for? But she says it's those things that broke me and brought me to the understanding so that when I heard about Jesus, I realized that's who I need in my life. That's trusting in God's promise protection, putting our faith in him and then resting in that. And then in verse 10 and 11, there's an acknowledgement also that the battle is not ours, but the battle is the Lord's. And so Jehoshaphat says, and now here are the people, and then we have come to, they have come to throw us out of your possession, which you have given to us. We are under this threat. But Lord, we come here, we find ourselves here, we have proclaimed the fast, we have gathered from everywhere to come and pray here in your presence. Because Lord, we know that the fight is not ours, the battle is not ours. And the Lord would make that very clear when the Spirit of the Lord fell on the servant of the Lord who then was instructed to lead the nation of Israel into that battle. And God communicated through there the understanding, the battle is not yours, it's mine. Whenever we find ourselves in threat, what a blessing to know, battle is not mine, it's the Lord's. On a very small scale, I remember when I was went to high school and I went to register in the ninth grade at Pontiac Central, and we were in the office and there was a group of other new freshmen and we were there registering. And I remember one girl who turned to me and says, aren't you afraid? And I said, and I didn't know the Lord at this time, but I said, afraid of what? And she says, well, you know, we hear all these reports of the violence in the school and there's always fights and riots and things like that. And my response was this, no, I'm not afraid because I know who's behind those fights. And the point was with me was that my brothers, Ivan and Louis, they were some of the kingpins behind a lot of those fights in the past. And I still remember that first day when I got to school. And some threat was there, and I remember someone say, don't touch him, that's a Quiñones. I thought, well, I have something going here. And so for 4 years, I just minded my business, went to school, but I never was afraid of the fights and riots because the reputation that my brothers left behind. The fight was already fought, in a sense, it was already fought for me. That's a small scale. We're talking here about the fight of life. We're talking about here about the fight for our souls and the fight for eternity. And we know that the battle is not ours. The battle is the Lord's. We have the Lord to trust in, to lean on, and to confide in. And then the last thing here I want to point out to you in verse 12 is that he also acknowledged how powerless they were while placing their dependence upon the Lord. And so in verse 12, he goes on to say, O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power against this great multitude that is coming against us, nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. What an important confession. In whatever battle we're facing, whatever threat comes to us, is to just simply understand, I'm not powerful enough to handle this. I'm powerless against this. But that's okay. Because my security is not in self. My security is in the Lord. Not only is it his battle, but the Lord, who is the sovereign, the authority, my Father, he's able to take care of me. And so, Lord, here we are to depend on you. And this is where you learn to wait on the Lord. And as Isaiah says, those who waited upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And there's a song that uses that verse. And the song ends with this phrase, teach me, Lord, to wait. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for your word. And thank you for this time of reflection. And we admit, Father, that literally there are many threats upon our lives. And they come in different forms, fashion, different times. And each one, from the smallest to the biggest, is really beyond what we can handle of ourselves. And I thank you, Father, that there's no shame in confessing that we are weak. There's no shame confessing that we are weak, because it is in our weakness that you have promised that your grace would be sufficient and that you would be strong in our lives. And Lord, you know the challenges that we are facing in our personal lives, but also the challenges that we are facing in the life of your church. Many of the challenges that come from the outside, and even challenges that are brewing from inside us. But Lord, help us that as we seek you, as we seek help from you, that our prayer focus would not be from the threat or from the need or from the troubles in our life and looking from there at you, but that we would learn to look at you from what your word reveals and look at the problems and the threat and the affliction from your eyes, with the understanding our God's in control. Our God is the sovereign. Our God is Lord of Lords. Our God has promised protection. Our God has all power. The battle's not ours. It's his. And therefore, in you and upon you, we wait. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. We're dismissed.